Good morning, friends. Welcome back to Zeitgeist, Second Sum Common. Today we are dealing with the second module, Environment. And here we have given a speech by Chief Seattle. The title is The End of Living and the Beginning of Survival. To talk about the background of Chief Seattle, he was the leader of the Suquamish tribe, the Native Americans in Western Washington and Metropolitan Seattle. In 1854, the government of the United States of America made an offer for a large area of Indian land and promised a reservation for the Red Indian people. And the reply of Chief Seattle to the proposal is given as a passage named with this title, The End of Living and the Beginning of Survival. And it remains a most beautiful and profound statement on environment and related issues. The origin of the speech is in their own native language, that is Lushoot Seed. And this Lushoot Seed language has been translated into many publications by many authors. And here we have the portion given by the translation by Henry A. Smith. Henry A. Smith, and which was published in Seattle Sunday Star in 1887, that we are dealing in this section. And Chief Seattle always addresses the great chief in Washington to the Governor Isaac Ignatius Stevens, the first governor of Washington, in this speech. Okay, let us start the speech. So the speech starts in this way. How can you buy or sell the sky, the warmth of the land? The idea is strange to us. If we do not own the freshness of the air and the sparkle of the water, how can you buy them? Here, Chief Seattle feels that it is impossible to buy or sell natural resources like air, water and land because we do not own them. They are a gift. He says that every part of the earth is sacred to him and to his people or to the Red Indians. They are a part of the earth and earth is a part of them. And then what is the possibility of buying or selling the land? Even the souls of the Native Americans do not leave their land. The first breath and the last breath exist there in that land. They make it their permanent residence. And their belief system is not be equated with the mainstream religions. And for them, for Red Indians, the earth is not an inanimate tract of land that you can buy, but a living presence to be treated with love, care, respect and fear. And how it comes in contrast with the ideas of white men, how white men deals with this environment. The white man does not understand our ways. One portion of land is the same to him as the next. There is nothing special for him. Because he is a stranger who comes in the night and takes from the land whatever he needs. The earth is not his brother, but his enemy. And here he leaves his father's grave behind and does not care. He kidnaps the earth from his children.
He treats his mother, the earth, and his brother, the sky, as things to be bought and sold. Just like buying or selling sheep or any bright beads, his appetite will devour the earth and leave behind only desert. How white man exploits earth? He can't consider the rivers as their brothers. And how, in contrast with this, you know how native Red Indians consider this land? The rivers are their brothers. They quench the rivers. They quench our thirst. The rivers carry our canoes and they feed our children. They are depending rivers for their livelihood. If we sell you our land, you must teach your children that the rivers are our brothers and yours too. Show kindness to the rivers as you would show to your brother. See, the given passages are a comparison between how white people considers their land and how the Red Indians believes in their own land. There is no quiet place in the white man's cities. There you can't hear the openings of leaves in spring or the rustle of an insect wings. They clatter only insults the ears. They feel the clattering sound of as insults or disturbance to their ears. What is there to life if a man can't hear the lonely cry of the whippoorwill? It is a kind of bird. Or the arguments of the frogs around a pond at night. You know, Red Indians enjoys this all things. And the Red Indians prefers the soft sound of the wind darting over the face of a pond scented with the smell of pine. You know, in each words you can feel the beauty of nature, the smell, the fragrance of nature. The air is precious to the red man because all things share the same breath, the beast, the tree, and man. The white man does not notice the air he breathes. And what happens if he sells our land? You must remember that the air is precious to us. You should not contaminate the air. Your industrialization will contaminate our air. The wind that gave our grandfather his first breath also receives his last sigh. So that is the importance of the air here. Here the soul will not leave the air. Their grandparents lives with them through that air. So keep it sacred where everyone can go and get the scent supplied by the meadows, flowers. And the chief adds some more things in his speech. He says, unfortunately, the white man has neither the sense nor the sensibility to feel the pulse of nature. And he ironically and sarcastically adds that perhaps the problem is with himself and his people. They are uneducated, uncultured, and uncivilized. The holistic vision of the speech is reiterated at the end within a theological framework. See, ironically he says, I'm a savage. I have seen 1,000 rotting buffaloes on the prairie left by the white man who shot them from a passing train. I'm a savage and I do not understand how the smoking iron horse or the train can be made more important than the buffalo that we kill only to stay alive. See, he uses sarcasm here, saying that, you know, we are savage. We can't understand why the white men are always shooting buffaloes. They are on the meadows just for entertainment. How the Red Indians kills them just to stay alive, just for livelihood. And They can't find any fun in shooting buffaloes. And what is man without beast? He is pointing the importance of animals, the equilibrium between humans and beast. What is man without beast? If all the beasts are gone, man would die from loneliness. Whatever happens to the beasts will soon happen to man. All things are connected. So, if you are buying our land, there is one condition. You must teach your children that the ground under their feet is the ashes of our grandparents. Tell your children that the earth is rich with the leaves of our kith and kin. So that they should respect the land. Teach your children as we have taught ours, that the earth is our mother. Whatever happens to the earth, it also happens to our sons. Okay, we can see, we always witness such things. You know, nature in return gives a lot of hazards, just like tsunami, earthquakes, and we have floods. So whatever happens to the earth, it also happens to our sons. If men spit upon the ground, they spit on themselves. And he is giving the statement that the earth does not belong to man and man belongs to the earth. All things are connected like blood which unites one family. Man did not weave the web of life. Man is merely a strand in it. Whatever he does to the web, he does it to himself. So, he concludes the speech by saying that when you die, you will shine brightly, fired by the strength of God who brought you to this land. For some special purpose, he gave you power over this land and over the red man. You know, anthropocentric view. Man is the supreme power in this earth. He is against Chief Seattle and Red Indians are against this idea. That destiny is a mystery to us. We do not understand why all the buffaloes should be killed. The wild horses are to be tamed. Forests are to be filled with men and the view of the hills spoiled by different kinds of fires. We can't understand these things. Why it is getting into a metropolitan city? Then there will be no ticket and no eagle. That is the end of living and the beginning of survival. So he warns the people that if you are ending the living of this earth, this environment, and there starts the beginning of survival, and that will be a threat to the humanity itself. And here he is defining what is living and what is surviving. Living is a meaningful existence with many activities, including hopes for the bright future. And here we nourish our environment too. Whereas survival is the bare minimum mode of existence in which a being struggles to remain alive somehow. So he has to fight with this